shall come with shouts of acclamation and take me home.
Amen.
What joy that shall bring. Then I shall bow in humble adoration and then proclaim, my God, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee, how great thou art. How great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee, how great thou art. How great thou art.
Amen. Who breaks the power of sin and darkness?
Who breaks the power of sin and darkness? Whose love is mighty and so much stronger? The King of glory, the King above all kings.
He shakes the whole earth.
Who shakes the whole earth with holy thunder and leaves us breathless and all in wonder? The King of glory, the King above all kings. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love.
You would take my place.
You would take my place. That you would bear my cross. You lay down your life. Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me.
Amen. Who brings our chaos back into order?
Who brings our chaos back into order? Who makes the orphan a son and daughter? The King of glory, the King of glory, who rules the nations with truth and justice, shines like the sun in all of its brilliance. The King of glory, the King above all kings. Yeah, this is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you would take my place. That you would bear my cross. You laid down your life that I would be set free. Oh, Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me.
Sing, worthy is the Lamb who was slain.
Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy, worthy, worthy. Oh, this is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you would take my place. That you would bear my cross. You laid down your life. That I would be saved.
set free. Oh, Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me. All that you've done for me. Amen. My song to rise to you.
So teach my song to rise to you. When temptation comes my way, and when I cannot stand, I'll fall on you. Jesus, you're my hope and stay.
Let's sing that again. Teach my song.
So teach my song to rise to you. When temptation comes my way, and when I cannot stand, I'll fall on you. Jesus, you're my hope and stay.
Lord, I need you.
Lord, I need you. Oh, I need you. Every hour, I need you. You're my one defense, my righteousness. Oh, God, how I need you.
You're my one defense.
You're my one defense, my righteousness. Oh God, how I need you.
Father, we love you. We thank you for loving us so much. Lord, we need you desperately. We're in a desperate situation in the world. There's so much sin that abounds, but your grace abounds even more. And we're so grateful for that. We are so excited that you are coming soon for us. We look forward to you, your return for us. We praise you for who you are and for all that you've done and continue to do. We thank you for your word this morning. We pray that you will bless and speak through Pastor Jason as he comes and shares your word. And we ask in the name of Jesus, amen.
All right, good morning. If you have your Bibles, which I hope you do, you can begin turning to Genesis chapter 30. Genesis chapter 30, we're picking up in our story with Jacob. And We've been going through February as we've been looking at the life of Jacob. We've been looking at this idea that God's grace is greater. We looked at God's patience is greater. We looked at his faithfulness is greater. And this week we're going to look at how God's word is greater. And so it got me thinking with all that's going on in the world and all that's happening. I started thinking, so how would you or how would I describe the average American to a foreigner? See, I remember when that question was asked of me when I was on a mission trip in Brazil. One of the young ladies in this group, she asked, so what if I moved to America, what would it be like? How would Americans treat me? What Americans value? What is an American? What does their life look like? What do they value? And it got me thinking, you know, how would we describe the priorities of Americans? What characteristics are valued by Americans? What describes them? What captivates the American culture? And just a lot of different thoughts went in and out of my mind, and things of like, well, we're Americans are passionate about sports, entertainment, food, politics. I mean, we can go on and on, right? There's a lot of things that we could say maybe that captivate the average American or things that describe what we love. And it got me thinking, so are these some of the things that are coming to mind that we describe that we're passionate about, these sports, entertainments, all these things? So why are things like sports and entertainment and food and politics and all these things so valued in our society? Why do we have common phrases like keeping up with the Joneses? And why do we have shows like, you know, the Kardashians or Desperate Housewives or Housewives of Atlanta and all these, I don't know what else the TLC throws out there, all these shows and everything like that. I had to go and look and scroll through and what shows are on these channels now. And just think, why do we have all these? Why do we spend, as Americans, why do we spend thousands upon thousands of dollars on sports and education and lifestyle conveniences? Why do we do all those things? Have you ever pondered that for a moment? Why is a society that we have chosen those things to value? And why we have poured so much money? Do you realize just youth baseball alone, when I say youth baseball, like 5 to 10-year-olds, is a multi-billion-dollar industry in America. Multi-billion-dollar industry. Is it because, why do we value those things? Is it because we think there is some sort of fulfillment guaranteed in these things? Well, is it because there's a belief that these things are fundamental needs to have a good life? See, throughout human history, we continuously make the mistake of valuing things that ultimately have zero eternal value. And at the same time, devaluing the Word of God that is the only thing that will endure. And I think it's obvious, if we were honest, that our society as a whole has determined that money and influence and material objects, sports, entertainment, politics, and many other things are actually more valuable than God's Word. You don't have to watch the news long to determine that. You don't have to look at social media long. You don't have to look at the TV shows and the movies being produced very long to see what we value as a culture. So of all the things in your life that are battling for supremacy, as believers, we must determine and purpose in our hearts to make sure that God's word is supreme over all the things that the world has to offer. The world should see that dedication as well. The world should see that believers value something greater than the rest of the world. They should see that we value the Word of God. And see, they're only going to see that we value the Word of God in as much as we apply and live out the Word of God. See, you can say all day long, oh, I love the Bible. I love the Word of God. The Word of God is meaningful to me. I treasure it. I love it. I have 9 Bibles at home. But that carries no meaning to the world if they do not see you living it out. And ultimately, it carries no meaning before a holy God if you're not living it out as well. So the world should see that we value the Word of God above all. So if you find yourself doing sports, you should be doing it for the glory of God. If you find yourself at Walmart, you should be shopping for the glory of God. If you've been to Walmart, you know there's a lot not doing that. And you must be thinking, well, if I'm living out in this world, what does that actually look like? That means that you're living out the Word of God. That means you're loving others, you're patient, you're kind, you're self-controlled, which patience, kindness, and self-control are not usually three characteristics I use to describe my experiences of Walmart. No offense, Jeff, who works there. Now, the pharmacy department, yeah, I get that. Everywhere else, right? And those words aren't necessarily what I would use to describe maybe our experiences at other places as well. Those things are lacking. Brothers and sisters, those things should never be lacking for believers. Wherever we find ourselves, we should be living out the Word of God. And so that's what we're going to be looking at this morning. Is Jacob going to respond and live out the Word of God? Is he going to kind of teeter with this? Well, maybe I can make my own way. And see, every culture, every generation deals with their temptations and their problems. And see, today our issues are very different than Jacob's issues in his day. See, Old Testament times, New Testament times, a lot of them were just trying to survive. Do you realize even as recent as the mid-1800s, people were just trying to survive? I mean, if you made it past 45, you were like, wow, you are old. Now, if you ask teenagers today, that 45 is still old, but now we get to say that's midlife. That's when you can have your midlife crisis. See, even back then, though, their midlife crisis had to happen at 19 because that was about halfway. And so they had different issues. They had different problems. See, but for us today, our issue and our problem is time. We have so much free time, more free time than any human has ever experienced in our human history. Especially Americans. We have more free time than anyone ever has. And the enemy is fighting for that time. And so are you going to determine with your time, is God's word greater? So picking up in chapter 30 and verse 25. It says, after Rachel gave birth to Joseph, Jacob said to Laban, send me on my way so that I can return to my homeland. Give me my wives and my children that I have worked for, and let me go. You know how hard I have worked for you. But Laban said to him, if I have found favor with you, stay. I have learned by divination that the Lord has blessed me because of you. Then Laban said, name your wages and I will pay them. So Jacob said to him, you know how I have served you, and how your herds have fared with me. For you had very little before I came, but now your wealth has increased. The Lord has blessed you because of me. And now, when will I also do something for my own family? Laban asked, what should I give you? And Jacob said, you don't need to give me anything, for I do this one thing for me. I will continue to shepherd and keep your flock. Let me go through all the sheep today and remove every sheep that is speckled or spotted, every dark-colored sheep among the lambs, and the spotted and speckled among the female goats. Such will be my wages. In the future, when you come to check on my wages, my honesty will testify for me. For if I have any female goats that are not speckled or spotted, or any lambs that are not black, they will be considered stolen. Good, said Laban. Let it be as you have said. That day Laban removed the streaked and the spotted male goats and all the speckled and spotted female goats, everyone that had any white on it, and every dark-colored one among the lambs, and he placed his sons in charge of them. He put a three-day journey between himself and Jacob. Jacob, meanwhile, was shepherding the rest of Laban's flock. Jacob then took branches of fresh poplar, almond, and plain wood and peeled the bark, exposing white stripes on the branches. He set the peeled branches in the troughs in front of the sheep, in the water channels where the sheep came to drink, and the sheep bred when they came to drink. The flocks bred in front of the branches and bore streaked, speckled, and spotted young. Jacob separated the lambs and made the flocks face the streaked sheep and the completed dark sheep in Laban's flocks. Then he set his own stock apart and didn't put them with Laban's sheep. Whenever the stronger of the flock were breeding, Jacob placed the branches in the troughs in full view of the flocks, and they would breed in front of the branches. As for the weaklings of the flocks, he did not put out the branches. So it turned out that the weak sheep belonged to Laban and the stronger ones to Jacob. And the man became very rich. He had many flocks, female and male slaves, and camels and donkeys. Now I know what you're thinking. Wow. When I read that passage, I think, man, God's word is so much better. But I want us to get a start into this. We read this section, and I want you to think of this for a second. What you're seeing between Laban and Jacob is a lot of distrust and deception. We've been seeing that for quite a while now between Laban and Jacob. We see that deception has become now commonplace. It's just expected. At this point, how much power or weight does Laban or Jacob's word carry with one another? Not very much at all. Why? Because they're sinners. They continue to walk in their sin. As the Bible tells us in Romans 3:23, for all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. At our heart, at our natural state, we are sinners and we are bent towards sin. And so we see here with Jacob, in his bent towards sin, he's leaning into that. And he is, again, deceiving. So Laban is lying to Jacob. Jacob is lying to Laban. They're deceiving one another. And what has become commonplace of lying and deception, whether they realize it or not, their lying and deception has now replaced God's word in their life. No longer are they submitting to the word of God, but they are submitting to making their own way. Jacob could have simply trusted God's word. God came to Jacob and said, go back to your land and I will provide all that you need. Now Jacob makes a request, hey, let me go back to my homeland. But meanwhile, I will make sure that I have enough. I will make my own way. And that's where we see the story of the sheep and the goat. Rather than just simply trusting that God was going to take care of him, Jacob thought, I will make sure. In that moment, he has taken God's word and put it underneath his own wisdom. God's word is not supreme in Jacob's life in this moment. And what does that produce? Deception. Deception is commonplace in our society as well. We see it all the time, right? You can't do anything today without a contract, it doesn't seem like, and witnesses and notaries. Why? Can't you just trust that I'm going to make all my house payments, bank? And they're like, no, we will not trust you. We will not trust you here. We will not trust you there. We will not trust you anywhere. Why is nothing trustworthy anywhere? Because sin is running rampant. We've seen it here in Jacob. We see it in our society today. We see it everywhere. God's word continuously takes a back seat to man's wisdom, which produces sin. So picking up in the story in chapter 31. In chapter 31, in verses 1 through 21, we see God speak twice, and we're going to look at those two times. So we're going to look at verses 1 through 3, and then verses 10 through 13. So verses 1 through 3, it says, "Now Jacob heard what Laban's sons were saying. Jacob has taken all that was our father's and has built this wealth from what belonged to our father. And Jacob saw from Laban's face that his attitude toward him was not the same as before. The Lord said to him, 'Go back to the land of your ancestors and to your family, and I will be with you.'" Then picking up in verses 10 through 13, "When the flocks were breeding, I saw in a dream that the streaked, spotted, and speckled males were mating with the females. In that dream, the angel of God said to me, 'Jacob,' and I said, 'Here I am.' And he said, 'Look up and see, all the males that are mating with the flocks are streaked, spotted, and speckled, for I have seen all that Laban has been doing to you. I am the God of Bethel, where you poured oil on the stone marker and made a solemn vow to me. Get up, leave this land, and return to your native land.'" So these two times that we see God speaking to Jacob, both times he tells them to get up and to return. And he says, "I will be with you." We're also seeing by contrast in this section that Jacob doesn't trust Laban's word and Laban doesn't trust Jacob's word again. And so it got me thinking, what is something that we can have 100% confidence in? And really, we can't have 100% confidence in anything in this world. Nothing. And see, we as believers understand that we can only have 100% confidence in God. See, there is a vast difference when Laban speaks a promise, when Jacob speaks a promise, and then when God speaks a promise. Because we're seeing, we can read, we can see Laban and Jacob, their words mean hardly nothing. They lie, they deceive continuously over and over again. But what we've seen from the beginning of Genesis all the way up to this point, when God speaks, it comes to pass. There is a stark difference between when Jacob and Laban speak and when God speaks. So, how do we live, or how does Jacob in this moment live like he has 100% confidence in God's word? God has come, he has spoken to Jacob, "Get up and go back, and I will be with you." So, how does Jacob live as if he has 100% confidence in God's word? By submitting to God's word. Psalm 119, 105, it's one of our favorite Vacation Bible School little kid verses that we learn as kids. "Your word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path." See, our level of confidence in God is exposed by how much influence God's word has over our lives. I want you to think about that for just a moment. Our level of confidence in God is exposed by how much influence God's word has over our lives. We are about to see how much confidence Jacob has in God, but how he responds to his word. Influence is one of the ways that we can measure confidence. We're seeing how much influence does Laban have over Jacob? None. Why? Doesn't trust him. How much influence does Jacob have over Laban, though? Well, zero. Why? Because Laban doesn't trust him. We've seen by contrast, though, how much influence does Rachel have over Jacob? A lot, because Jacob loves her. And so when I got to this point of the story and reading and seeing, okay, Laban has spoken, Jacob has spoken, but now God has spoken, what is Jacob going to do? And it got me thinking, how much influence are we giving to other people and other things other than to God's word? How much influence are we giving to the world, to people, to politics, to money, to jobs, spouses, family, friends? I mean, for our culture, how much influence are we giving to Oprah? versus how much confidence and influence are we giving to the Word of God? See, we need to put our confidence in God's Word so that God's Word can have the greatest influence over our life. See, when you face any moment of life, your natural response should be to go to God's Word. That's where we turn for wisdom. That's where we turn for insight. That's where we turn for understanding. A while ago, I quoted Psalm 119:105. Your word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path. And we love that verse, but very few times do we go beyond that verse. See, Psalm 119 is a wonderful chapter. I encourage you to read it. It's all about the Word of God and its importance in its life, and it's broken into sections. And so when you come to Psalm 119, you come to this section. The section is verses 105 through 112. Now, we all know 105, but very few of us actually know what follows, verses 106 through 112. So when you think of your word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path, what does that mean? Verses 106 through 112 explain exactly what that means. Verse 106, it says, I have solemnly swore to keep your righteous judgments. So when he says your word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path, he means there first that I am committed to the word of God. There is a commitment to the word of God. Verse 107, I am severely afflicted. Lord, give me life according to your word. So when he says your word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto a path, he means when he finds himself afflicted, he is able to endure affliction because of the word of God. Verse 108, Lord, please accept my freewill offerings of praise and teach me your judgments. So when he says your word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto a path, what he means that when he comes to worship, it produces a desire to be taught the Word of God. You want to know if you've truly worshiped God or not? Do you desire to be taught the Word? If you don't leave worship desiring to know the Word of God, to be taught by the Word of God, you have not worshiped. 109, my life is constantly in danger, yet I do not forget your instruction. So when he says, your word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path, that means when he faces difficulty and danger, his security is found in God's word. Verse 110, the wicked have set a trap for me, but I have not wandered from your precepts. What's it mean when he says, your word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path? That means when he faces temptation, temptation is only defeated by the word of God. Verse 111, I have your decrees as a heritage forever. Indeed, they are the joy of my heart. What's it mean when you say the word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path? You mean that God's word is your source of joy. And then finally, verse 112, I am resolved to obey your statutes to the very end. So when you say your word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path, what you mean is that you will cling to the word of God to your final breath. Because you know that everything else will pass away, but the Word of God will endure forever. Jesus affirms that in Matthew 24, verse 35, and it's repeated in Luke 21, 33. Heaven and earth will pass away, but my words will never pass away. So you look at what Jacob has come to at this moment. Laban has spoken, Jacob has spoken, and the Lord has spoken. God has spoken. When God speaks, are we willing to respond? Are we willing to follow? Are we willing to trust? Do we really believe that God's word is a light unto our path? Do we really believe those things that we say? So we've mentioned that God we've seen through Genesis 1 all the way up to this point in 31 that God has been faithful to his word over and over and over and over again. And oftentimes we focus in on that, hey, God does this, God does this, God does this. That's how we can know he's faithful. See, we can also know that God is faithful by what he doesn't do. We can know that God is faithful because God doesn't lie. God can't deny himself. God doesn't break his promises. God never approves of sin. God never stops loving his people. God never gives his glory to another. God never pardons without the atonement. See, to fully know God and understand him, you need to be aware of who he is and who he isn't, what he loves, what he hates, how he works, how he doesn't work. At this point, as little faithfulness to God we have seen in Jacob, and we've seen very little up to this point, we at least see moments where he trusts God's word for a moment. And we've also talked about these contrasts we've seen between Cain and Abel, Isaac and Ishmael, and Jacob and Esau. And we've noticed and we've highlighted those slight differences between those men is not some innate goodness where somehow Abel or Jacob or Isaac were somehow these wonderful, amazing people, and that's why God used them. What we're seeing is just these little responses, this willingness to have a little bit of repentance, to have a little bit of obedience to God's word. And just these simple acts of obedience to God's word has created this massive separation. See, often Christians wander around looking for these massive, amazing movements of God. We're like, we want to experience these incredible things. And so what we do as Christians is we try to manufacture these movements and these experiences because we're seeking these massive movements of God. We like, I want my parting of the Red Sea moment. I want my slaying of the giant moment. I want these massive, huge Christian God moments. And so we find ourselves trying to manufacture these things. But the reality of it is, God does these amazing, wonderful things through simple obedience to his word. You want a mighty movement of God in your life? Read the Bible and do what it says. See, Moses experienced a mighty movement of God because God said, do this, and he did it. Moses didn't like, I want to experience God. Okay, where's the praise band? Okay, where's the fog machines? We need lights. We need mood. We need set. He's just like, God said do this, so he did that. That is the normal, typical way that God works, is through simple acts of obedience to his word. Why? Because God's word is powerful. In Hebrews, we read that it's sharper than any two-edged sword, piercing the heart. So it pierces the heart. God's word reveals God himself to us. God's word endures to the end. God's word guides us. It defeats temptation. It exposes deception and lies and falsehoods. Our words do not have that power. Our words do not have that ability. We cannot manufacture a movement of God. You and I cannot manufacture that. If you want to see God move in mighty ways, Jacob is at this moment. If he wants to see God do incredible things in his life, all he has to do is just obey. I believe there's a hymn about that or something somewhere. Trust and obey, for there's no other way to be happy in Jesus. To further display the power of God's word, we read in Ephesians chapter 6 that we only have one offensive weapon in the battle with our enemy. And what is our enemy? In the Ephesians 6:12, it says our battle is against the rulers, against the authorities, against the cosmic powers of this darkness, against evil spiritual forces in the heavenly places. Just like if you continue reading in Psalm 119, past verse 105, you see that our only hope in battling sin, in battling evil, and navigating this world is the Word of God. And not just knowing about it or reading it, but actually applying it and living it out. And so we see Jacob at a crossroad. God's word has been spoken. How will he respond? So we're going to summarize the rest of chapter 31 by reading verses 41 through 44. Beginning of verse 41. Jacob speaking, he says, "For 20 years in your household I served you. 14 years for your two daughters and 6 years for your flocks, and you have changed my wages 10 times. If the God of my father, the God of Abraham, the fear of Isaac, had not been with me, certainly now you would have sent me off empty-handed. But God has seen my affliction and my hard work, and he issued his verdict last night." Then Laban answered Jacob, "The daughters are my daughters, the sons my sons, and the flocks my flocks. Everything you see is mine, but what can I do today for these daughters of mine or for the children they have born? Come now, let us make a covenant, you and I, let it be a witness between the two of us." Two observations. One, Laban and Jacob in this section decide to make a covenant. Do they fully trust each other? Yeah, probably not. But nonetheless, they make a covenant. Also, we see Jacob still with this theme of referring to God as the God of Abraham and the God of Jacob. He still is not saying, "my God." And you're thinking, like, even Jacob recognizes, he says, "Look, I mean, I wouldn't be here at this point had it not been for the God of Abraham and the God of Isaac. And I wouldn't be here. God has continuously provided for me." But he's still talking as if God is far off. Have you ever wondered how people could experience so much of God's grace and patience and faithfulness and love and not be fully bought in? Has it ever caused you to wonder how could that be possible? Well, we should know. Because we are all that way, in some way, shape, or form. All of us have experienced an abundance of God's grace, and patience, and faithfulness. But we're still kind of like Jacob. We're only half in. We're not fully bought in to all that God has for us. And we see that by our lack of commitment to the Word of God. You want to know if you're fully bought in? Look at how much influence the Word of God has in your life. Look at Jacob. God said, "Get up and go, and I'll be with you." Jacob's like, "Well, I'll get up and do the going, but I'm going to provide my own way." Jacob is half in. And so I want us to reflect for just a moment on our faith. Romans 10:17, it says, "Faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the word of God." Your faith is rooted in the influence God's word has over your life. You want to grow your faith? You want your faith to blossom and to mature and to move. It is directly tied to how much you read and apply the Word of God. I think Marty does a phenomenal job. He can sing and he can play the guitar better than I could with 1,000 years of practice. Okay, maybe 3,000 years of practice. Okay, never. I'll never get there. But Marty can do a phenomenal job up here. It will not move your faith like the Word of God. I can get up here and do the best I've ever done, but I cannot move your faith. Only the Word of God can. Stop trying to manufacture your faith. Stop trying to manufacture a movement of God in your life. Go read the Word of God, do what it says, and then you can sit back and watch God do amazing things. And you'll not have to manufacture a bit of it. But the question is, that came to Jacob as well, ultimately, do you trust God's word more than you trust your own wisdom and understanding? Too often, I see people trying to make their own way. Too often, I try to make my own way. Too often, we throw out justifications. Jacob here, look at what he's trying to justify. I've worked all these years, 20 years. I deserve something. But see, if you remember what Abraham say, after Abraham bought in fully to God, when people tried to give him stuff and give him flocks, what'd he say? No. I don't need that because God's going to take care of me, and I don't want anybody to say that I made you rich. I gave you this. He's like, I'm going to show everyone that God took care of me. Jacob, not yet fully in, says, I'm taking this stuff because I deserve it. I want this stuff. And what did Laban say? I have made you rich. There's a difference between you, the way you live when you're fully bought in to the Word of God and when you're half in. There is a massive difference. And sadly, we see all throughout the church today a lot of people who are half in. You're not fully bought in because you perceive that God's word sometimes is just too hard, or that there's an easier way, or that there's a better way. There is not a better way, and there is not an easier way than God's word. But do you believe that? Are you fully bought in? Remember that you have an enemy that is constantly and consistently trying to convince you that there are things in this world that are greater than God's word, that deserve more of your time, that deserve more of your attention, and deserve to be more influential in your life. The enemy does not sleep. It does not stop. It is a constant bombardment. So we must determine within our hearts as believers, your word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path. Affliction may come, I will turn to God's word. Temptation will come, I will turn to God's word. We can't really talk about the importance of God's word in your life today without mentioning what's happening to believers in Ukraine. I know there's a lot of political things going on, Russia and Ukraine and what's happening and regime changes and all that kind of stuff. But at this moment, there are Christians in Ukraine. And whether we want to say it or not, Russia is not pro-biblical Christianity. Russians are persecuted. I know it doesn't make the news very much, but when they roll through Ukraine, there's going to be a persecution of Christians. They don't have their buildings. They don't have their pews. They don't have their songs. They don't have their preachers. You know what they do have, though? The Word of God. We cannot be deceived. We can't deceive ourselves into thinking that we need all this other stuff. Yes, music, phenomenal. We're called in Scripture. Hey, speak to each other in psalms, hymns, spiritual songs. Music is a wonderful. It should be, if it can be, part of the Christian life. Preaching, we're commanded in Scripture. That has to be done when we gather. Gatherings. The youth went to a basketball game yesterday. It was a lot of fun. It was great and wonderful. But if we're personally not reading and applying the Word of God, none of that matters. None of it has meaning. If we as individuals, I'll say it again, are not reading and applying the Word of God, me and Marty are meaningless to the church. Because your faith will only grow when you are reading and applying the Word of God. And we cannot do that for you. Your spouse cannot do that for you. Your parent cannot do that for you. Jacob's at a crossroad. Is he all in or half in? I give you a hint. He's half in on God's word. But next week we're going to read there's a transition in Jacob's life where he goes from kind of in to more all in. And we're going to see a very different Jacob. There'll be a very different you versus kind of in and all in. Now I pray that you be all in. Because we never know what's going to happen. It could be next month, we could be in the same boat as those Ukrainian Christians. All we have is the Word of God. And you know what stories are coming out of Ukraine right now with Christians? People are being saved. God's Word is flourishing. Imagine that. Because there's one thing that can never be destroyed. And that is the Word of God, because it will endure forever. Let us pray. Father, we want to thank you so much for your grace and your love that you have given us. That we can know you, that we can worship you in truth and in spirit, that we can be forgiven of our sins, we can be cleansed from all unrighteousness. We want to thank you for your graciousness, your faithfulness, your patience towards us. We also want to thank you that you have given us your word so that we can know you. That we can be guided through this life and have the privilege of glorifying you along the way. So, Father, we ask that you help us to be a people that are not only hearers of your word, but doers as well. That we would truly embrace your word as a lamp unto our feet and a light unto our path. Lord, help us to be such people of your word that when we come across people in Franklin County and across our state and across the world, they may be able to say a lot of things about us, but the number one thing would be that we are people of your word, that we are all in. And it's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. At this time, we're going to stand and we're going to sing. And we're going to take a moment and praise God. But I want you to reflect upon and think about, are you all in on God's word? Are you all in on his word? Let's stand. Let's sing.
Things of earth will grow.
strangely dim in the light of His glory and grace.
Let's sing it together again.
Turn